Hello everyone, welcome to Teaching Paathshala. This is the second part of Developmental Biology of Drosophila, in which we are going to study about the formation of an anterior and posterior axis. If you have not seen the first part of this video, then I will mention the link in the last of this video as well as in the description box. In my very first video of Developmental Biology, I have already told you that whatever the process which used to occur in the developmental area, that will only occur in a sequential way. So, the sequence which is going to follow in the developmental biology of Drosophila is the first will be the fertilization, then it will going to follow with the cleavage. After that, there is the occurrence of a gastrulation process, and after the gastrulation, there is a formation of an axis, mainly the anterior posterior axis and the dorsal and the ventral axis. And the last step will be the formation of a body segment or the body segmentation. So first we are going to talk about the fertilization. So this is the egg of a Drosophila, in which you can see that there is an anterior and the posterior axis. Although this anterior and the posterior axis is not determined yet, it used to determine after the fertilization. So just for the convenience to explain, that is why I have kept the polarity, that is the anterior and the posterior, so that you will be able to know that what is the side of a micropyle region and what is the side of a nucleus. So in the fertilization, it is mainly regarded that the sperm used to enter through this micropyle region, which you can see in the figure, and egg have begun to specify the axis by the point of fertilization. So fertilization is an event after which our egg start to make a different kind of a protein, and that will be going to be responsible for the axis formation in a Drosophila. And this is a point where the stored mRNA is going to be followed by a translation, that means the production of a protein. The next main important point is that the Drosophila used to follow the superficial or the syncytial cleavage. And this term is very, very important, because sometime in part B of CSIRNet, they used to ask this question that what type of cleavage process is mainly accepted by Drosophila. So you should remember that what is superficial cleavage, what is syncytial cleavage. Although I'm going to cover this portion in our upcoming slide, that what is it. This is a diagram in which you are going to see all the different process or the developmental process that is going to occur in a Drosophila. So we are going to start with the new egg. So initially there is a formation of a new egg, and after that there is an encounter of a sperm from the micropyle region, and that sperm makes an entry into the egg, and finally the N cell, that was the haploid egg cell, and the haploid sperm cell together they will meet, and they are going to form a zygote, and this is called the fertilized egg. Now this zygote is a diploid in nature, because it is having a one type of a chromosome that has been came from mother, and one type of a chromosome that it has been came from father. So that is why the zygote is regarded as a diploid. After that, there is a occurrence of a karyokinesis. Karyo means nucleus, kinesis means the division. So that is why it is known as the karyokinesis. That means the cytoplasm of zygote will remain totally constant, but the nucleus or the nuclei will start dividing in a rapidly manner. And this concept you should remember, that there is a no division in a cytoplasm. Only the nucleus will divide and cytoplasm will remain constant as it is. After that, the nuclei migrate to the periphery and the pole cell formation will take place. In the diagram, you can see that initially all the nucleus were present in the center. But after the karyokinesis, or the unlimited amount of a karyokinesis, this nuclei will start migrating to the periphery of the cell. Periphery means you can see the location of a periphery. Okay, so the nucleus will start to migrate to the periphery region. And after that, there is a formation of a pole cell that you can see in the very terminal portion. So the pole cell formation and the nuclei migrate to the periphery, these two processes will take place. What happened after that? There is a formation of a syncytial blastoderm. So this is a condition which is called as a syncytial. That means all the nuclei will going to be located just around the surface, that is in a periphery region. And this is a condition which is regarded as a syncytial blastoderm. The overall egg is now from the middle, it is totally empty, and all the nuclei has been covered the interior and the terminal interior portion. So that is why it is known as the syncytial blastoderm. And after that, you can see there is a formation of a cellular blastoderm. What is the meaning of cellular blastoderm? So in the syncytial blastoderm, you can see that there is still a incomplete cell membrane formation. Okay, from the inner side, there is an opening of a cell membrane. But if you see the cellular blastoderm, the overall nuclei has been covered with a fully developed plasma membrane or the cell membrane. And that is a condition which is called the cellular blastoderm, because the cellularization of a nuclei has been taken place. And after this, that is the embryo, now the total embryo has been developed. And after this, there will be the axis formation and segmentation. And after the axis formation and segmentation, there will be the larval stage of a Drosophila. And we are going to study about this axis formation. That means we are going to study the process just after the embryo formation. Although, like, I don't feel that it should be described, but I know that many of your students are not familiar with the proper developmental process. So it is just a summary that what is actually happening before the axis formation. Because this concept is very important, you should know that from where the overall process has been started, what is the need of axis formation, and what is the like proper timing or the proper location of a axis formation. So now you can get that the after the embryo formation, there is an occurrence of a axis formation. So this slide I have kept, in which you are going to get an important point regarding the superficial cleavage. So let's read it once. It is also known as a syncytial blastoderm, and I have already explained the definition of that. The zygote nucleus undergoes several mitotic division within the central portion of an egg. And this is what the actual definition of a syncytial blastoderm, because the nucleus only used to divide through a mitotic division and the cytoplasm remained constant. Only nuclear division will take place by mitosis, but cytoplasm remain constant, meaning that all the cleavage nuclei are contained within a common cytoplasm. When the nuclei reach the periphery of an egg during the 10th cleavage cycle, and these nuclei become enclosed by a cell membrane. Okay, so this enclosing of a cell membrane stage is known as a cellular blastoderm. But when this nuclei used to reach to the periphery of an egg, at that time it is known as a syncytial blastoderm, because till that time there is an incomplete cell membrane formation. But when there is a complete cell membrane formation, after that it will be regarded as a cellular blastoderm, and before that it will be regarded as a syncytial blastoderm. So the difference between these two terms, that is what is syncytial blastoderm and what is cellular blastoderm, should be clear in your mind. So during the axis formation, that is mainly the anterior and the posterior, you are going to see different kind of a maternal genes which are going to play a very important role during the axis formation, that is the anterior and the posterior axis. So the genes about which we are going to talk in this video is the bicoid, hunchback, nanos and caudal. And along with that, we will see some more genes which will going to play a very important role. And the example of that genes are the Oscar and Stephen. Now let's begin with the anterior and the posterior axis formation. So first of all, we are going to talk about the maternal genes. So what is maternal genes? Maternal genes are expressed in oocytes before the fertilization, and this is the very important property of our maternal genes. These genes used to express themselves before the fertilization, that means before the mating of a sperm and an egg. And in that condition, they used to reside in a mRNA form. So in next point, it has been mentioned that there is total two maternal mRNA. First is the bicoid and second is the nanos, which used to help in the formation of an anterior and the posterior axis. So you have to remember these two genes, that is one is bicoid, second is nanos. And these two genes are very, very important genes which used to play an important role in anterior and the posterior axis formation. Next is that nerve cell secretes bicoid mRNA into the oocytes. The nerve cell of an ovary deposit mRNA in our developing oocytes. So we are going to study about all these points in an upcoming diagram, so that we will understand it in a better way. This is a diagram of an egg chamber, or you can say that egg or oocyte. So we are going to talk about some very important points regarding this diagram. So you have to listen to it very carefully. You can see the area, or you can see the site of the anterior follicle cell as well as the posterior follicle cells. The area in which you can see a black dot, that white area will be known as a nurse cell. So nurse cell has the property to nourish the egg. Whatever the important nutrients are required by the oocytes, that has been provided by the nurse cell. And you can see the area that is shaded in a red portion, that is the location of a bicoid mRNA synthesis, and the green portion is designated for the nanos mRNA synthesis. So the area which is located in our diagram, that is the area for the synthesis of the bicoid mRNA and nanos mRNA, as well as you can see the position of a oocyte, that is in a posterior region. The bicoid mRNA mainly used to be secreted from the nurse cell. Now, the second important point. Firstly, the nanos mRNA used to be synthesized in the anterior portion, and the bicoid mRNA, it used to synthesize in a posterior portion. But after the mRNA synthesis or the respective mRNA synthesis, the bicoid mRNA will migrate to the anterior portion and the nanos mRNA will migrate to the posterior portion. Until the overall developmental process, they remains in that position only. That is, the bicoid will remain in an anterior portion and nanos will remain in a posterior portion. Third important point is that from the previous slide, we came to know that the nanos and the bicoid both are the maternal genes, and that is why they are expressed before the fertilization. You can see from the figure that there is a presence of a bicoid mRNA and the nanos mRNA. So this mRNA formation has been taken place before the fertilization, that means before the meeting of a sperm and egg. But after the meeting of a sperm and egg, this mRNA is going to be translated into a respective protein. That means now the bicoid mRNA is present in the anterior portion and nanos mRNA is going to be present in a posterior portion. So in this position, they remain till that point when this egg is not fertilized. But after the fertilization of the egg, this nanos mRNA is going to convert into a nanos protein and the bicoid mRNA is going to convert into a bicoid protein. So this concept should be clear that before the fertilization, they always remain in a mRNA form. And they remain in that position till the fertilization is not occurred. After the occurrence of a fertilization, the nanos mRNA going to convert into a nanos protein and the bicoid mRNA is going to be converted into a bicoid protein. Through each and every process of developmental biology of Drosophila, you have to remember one thing very clearly, that the bicoid mRNA and the bicoid protein, they will going to reside in the anterior portion of a embryo, and the nanos protein will going to reside in the posterior portion of an embryo, because these are the two factors which is going to decide that which side is going to develop into an anterior and which side is going to develop into a posterior. Fifth important point is that due to the presence of a bicoid protein at the anterior side, that side is regarded as an anterior. If you will try to insert the bicoid protein somewhere else in the embryo, that side will also become the anterior portion of that embryo. Okay, so the concept is that bicoid is going to determine the anterior side of a Drosophila, and presence of nanos is going to determine the posterior side of a Drosophila. This concept will become more clear in an upcoming portion. Now let's talk about the two more maternal genes, and these genes are hunchback and caudal. Before we have dealt with this bicoid and nano gene, now we are going to deal with the hunchback and the caudal gene. All these four genes are regarded as the maternal genes. So let's understand it in a short story form, then only we can get it in a easiest way. So what happened actually, the first graph is showing you the position in a oocyte. That means it is a graph before the fertilization. So what happened actually, there is a high concentration of a bicoid mRNA at the anterior side, because the bicoid mRNA after the synthesis, it has been migrated to the anterior side. And if you talk about the nanos mRNA, the concentration of a nanos mRNA will going to be very high at the posterior end of a egg. Now what happened? There is a presence of a two more maternal genes, that is the hunchback and the caudal. So hunchback and the caudal mRNA, they remain in a equal concentration throughout the whole egg. Okay, it's not just like the bicoid and nanos that they are present in a anterior, like bicoid is present in a very high concentration at the anterior and there is a no presence of bicoid at the posterior end. And if you talk about the nanos, nanos is present in a very high concentration at the posterior end, but there is an absence, completely absence of this nanos mRNA at the anterior end. But if you talk about the hunchback and caudal, they are equally distributed throughout the egg. Okay, and this is an event before the fertilization. Now let's talk about what happened after the fertilization. From the graph, you can see that after the fertilization, the bicoid and bicoid, nanos, hunchback and caudal, these all mRNA has been translated into their respective proteins. That is the bicoid protein, nanos protein, hunchback protein and the caudal protein. And what happened in the level of their concentration is that the bicoid protein or the bicoid mRNA, initially it was very high at the anterior portion. So after the formation of a protein also, it will remain in a very high concentration at the anterior portion. And this bicoid protein will remain in a very low concentration at the posterior position. And if you talk about the nanos protein will remain in a very high concentration at the posterior position and in a very low concentration at the anterior position. But there is a change in the concentration of a hunchback and caudal after the fertilization. So
द बाइकॉइड इज अ इनिशिएटर और द एक्टिवेटर ऑफ अ हंचबैक. सो दैट इज वाई द हंचबैक इज गोइंग टू शो इट्स वेरी हाई कंसेंट्रेशन एट द एंटीरियर पोर्शन एंड कॉडल इज सम हाउ इट इज एक्टिवेटेड और इट इज लाइक सिनर्जिट और इट इज अ लाइक यू कैन से इट इज अ पार्टनर ऑफ अ नैनोज प्रोटीन. सो द कॉडल इज गोइंग टू शो अ वेरी हाई कंसेंट्रेशन एट द पोस्टीरियर एंड. सो इन नॉर्मल समरी वी कैन से दैट the bicoid and hunchback they will going to work together and nanos and caudal they are going to work together and from the graph also it has been designated that the bicoid and the hunchback protein is going to have a very high concentration at the anterior side and nanos and caudal they are going to show a very high concentration at the posterior side and this condition we are going to see after the fertilization that is the in a early embryo stage. And the expression of the two genes, that is the bicoid protein and the hunchback protein, will going to make that side into a anterior portion. And the expression of the nanos and the caudal protein at particular site is going to make that side as a posterior one. So we can say that the hunchback and bicoid protein is going to decide the anterior side or the anterior axis. And nanos and caudal is going to decide the posterior axis of our Drosophila. Now I hope that the concept of hunchback, bicoid, caudal and nanos is clear to you because I have tried my best to explain you in as simple way as I can. Now let's move to the next slide in which we are going to talk about these four genes but in some different expression. Let's consider this circle as a Drosophila embryo, okay? And you can see the mentioning of the anterior portion and the posterior portion. Now one thing new I would like to mention here that the anterior portion is going to give rise to the head and the thorax portion of our Drosophila and the posterior portion will be going to converted into an abdominal segment. So you should remember that the anterior portion will contain the head and thorax and posterior will contain the abdomen segment. Now comes to the genes. And in the previous video only we have discussed that at the anterior portion there is the expression of a bicoid and the hunchback protein. And in the posterior portion there is a presence of a nanos and the caudal protein. The hunchback protein will lead to the expression of a side which will be regarded as the anterior portion and the nanos and caudal will going to be give rise to the posterior axis of a Drosophila. Now the next concept is that the bicoid and hunchback or you can say that the bicoid is going to inhibit the expression of a nanos and caudal at the anterior portion and that is the reason that why the nanos and caudal is only expressed in the posterior portion not in the anterior because bicoid is going to inhibit the nanos and caudal at the anterior portion and it will not let nanos and caudal to express in the anterior portion. And if we talk about the nanos and caudal, the nanos and caudal will be going to inhibit the bicoid and hunchback at the posterior portion so that these two genes, that is the bicoid and hunchback, will not going to express into the posterior portion. So this is a reason that why the bicoid and hunchback will remain in the anterior portion and why the nanos and caudal will remain in the posterior portion. Next point is that wherever there is a presence of a bicoid and hunchback, there will be the absence of a nanos and caudal, and the area in which there is a presence of a nanos and caudal, there will be the absence of bicoid and hunchback. So in summary, we can say that the bicoid and hunchback will give rise to the anterior axis of a Drosophila and nanos and caudal will give rise to the posterior axis of a Drosophila. The area where the bicoid and hunchback is present, there will be the absence of nanos and caudal, and the area in which the nanos and caudal is present, there will be the absence of a bicoid and hunchback. From the figure, you can see the overall shaded region, and that shaded region is going to designate that what is actually a morphogen gradient. So bicoid is acting as a morphogen gradient and you can see that there is a high concentration of bicoid at the anterior side and low concentration of a bicoid at a posterior side. And if you talk about the nanos and caudal, there is a high concentration or the high gradient of a nanos and caudal at the posterior side and there is a low concentration of a nanos and caudal at a anterior side. This is a one more figure in which you can see the location of a head, thorax and abdomen. Because in the previous slide, we have discussed that the anterior portion will going to result in a head and thorax and posterior portion will going to result in the abdomen formation. So you can see that what is the head portion or what is the head area, then the location of a thorax. So this head and thorax will going to express a maternal gene, that is the bicoid and hunchback. And this will be regarded as the anterior part of a Drosophila. The posterior part will include the abdomen segment and this abdomen segment will be formed with the expression of a nanos and caudal. So the concept is that
The posterior portion will include the nanus and caudal, and the anterior portion will include the bicoid and hunchback. And in the further process, this anterior portion is going to develop into a head and thorax, and the posterior portion is going to develop into an abdomen. So we can indirectly say that due to the expression of a bicoid and hunchback, there will be the expression of a head and thorax into a Drosophila. And due to the expression of a nanus and caudal, there will be the development of an abdomen in a Drosophila. This is a one more diagram in which you can see the mentioning of a bicoid mRNA in a cytoplasm as well as the nanos mRNA in a cytoplasm. And this is a condition when there is an absence of a fertilization. Still, the fertilization has not taken place, because after the fertilization, this mRNA is going to convert into a protein. And that is the reason that why this maternal mRNA or the protein of this egg is going to determine the body axis, because the bicoid and nanos, which is reside in the anterior and posterior respectively, they are going to determine the body axis, that is the anterior and the posterior axis. These are some important points about which I have already made a discussion in the previous slide, but although we can go through that. So the first point is that the bicoid mRNA are located in the anterior portion of an unfertilized egg, that means before the fertilization. Second point, the nanos mRNA is present at the posterior region of an unfertilized egg. This is also clear. Third point, the hunchback and the caudal mRNA are distributed throughout the oocyte. So this is a condition before the fertilization when hunchback and caudal, they will remain in an equal proportion in all over the oocyte. Fourth point, upon fertilization, these mRNAs can be translated into a protein, that is the nanos mRNA, bicoid mRNA, hunchback mRNA, and the caudal mRNA. They all will going to be translated into a protein after the fertilization. The next point, the building block of anterior-posterior axis patterning in Drosophila are laid out during the egg formation, that is the oogenesis, well before the egg is fertilized and deposited. The maternal effect genes are responsible for the polarity of the egg of our embryo. The developing egg or oocyte is polarized by a differentially localized mRNA molecules. So in short, they want to say that the polarization of the particular egg is going to be decided by the maternal mRNA. Now let's take one question from CSINET 2011. Which of the following maternal effect genes product regulate production of an anterior structure in a Drosophila embryo? So simply they want to know that which maternal genes are responsible for the regulation of an anterior structure or the anterior axis. So the options are bicoid and nanos. So first of all, the bicoid is present in anterior and nanos is present in posterior. So this option is eliminated. Second is the bicoid and hunchback. So this is the correct answer, because bicoid and hunchback both used to be present in the anterior portion, and they will going to regulate the formation of an anterior axis. Okay. The third point is bicoid and caudal. Again, bicoid is going to be take part in an anterior axis formation, and caudal is going to take part in the posterior axis formation. So this option is also eliminated. Fourth option is nanos and caudal. So these two genes is going to take part in the formation of a posterior axis, not the anterior. So the correct answer is the answer 2, that is bicoid and hunchback will going to regulate the formation of an anterior structure in a Drosophila. Still, I have left with total 10 slides of this video, but I think it has already been, I guess, more than 25 minutes. So I guess it would be better if I can make a part 2 of this video. So I'm just ending this video right here. And after this, you are going to get the second part of this video, in which I'm going to discuss about some more genes. But that part will be going to be the continuation of this anterior and posterior axis formation. Because if I continue right now, I think it will be more than 50 minutes video, because still there is a lot of stuff has been left. That is mainly the mutation cases study, that what happened if bicoid is not there, what happened if a nanos is not there. So I think there will be the need of a second part of this video. So till now, I'm going to finish this video at this point. I'm going to discuss more about this in the second part of this video.